I'm a doctor, as you all know, and I come from a place where doctors are revered and again considered next to God. But again, as you can see, like manhandled and marauded when things go wrong. But as a doctor, I have an entirely different experience where people came together. They supported us in when we faced an emergency. Again, we come from a nation which is having different cultures and known for its diversity. But this diversity, when it put together, it can be a very strong power that can make changes. So I'll explain or narrate a story, of a disease that has produced so many issues in our area. As a doctor, I'm not going to tell you the medical statistics or the disease symptoms, details about the virus or the structures, how the disease is spreading or how it was contained. But I would like to tell you how the people come together to fight against this deadly Nipah virus, and again, how we could have form a teamwork to fight against this adversity. I'll just go through how we made the diagnosis. In May 2018, we had a patient, a 26-year-old man. He was initially admitted in a local hospital with fever, breathing difficulty, and altered sensorium. Then later on, he was shifted to my unit as he was becoming sick. As he was very unstable when he presented to our hospital, he was admitted in my intensive care unit. So on detailed history taking, he revealed that, his family members revealed that, his brother has died almost 2 weeks back in nearby government hospital with almost similar symptoms. So what we thought was, if he's getting a disease from a person who's died almost 2 weeks back, it is likely that the first person might have infected other people as well. So we specifically asked, is there any other family members who are having the similar symptoms, fever or breathing difficulty, or any other neighbors or the persons in that area, or the persons whom the first patient was already exposed, they are having any symptoms? So initially they denied. But later on, they told that the three of the family members are also having fever, but they are all doing fine in their home. They have taken treatment from the local hospital. They don't have any issues. But on request, they got admitted. I went and personally examined all these three patients. They were absolutely fine, except for the fever. They were not having much problems. So we have convinced them that for observation, these patients also should be admitted. So we admitted those patients as well. So by evening, all these three, two out of these three also became sick. So we have already three sick patients by that time in the ICU. And again, these patients had unusual symptoms. Usually when the patient is having the fever altered sensorium, we think about something a brain infection. We call it as encephalitis. So we have seen many cases of encephalitis in our practice. But these patients were having some peculiar symptoms which are not seen in usual encephalitis patients. So here we have a patient who died 2 weeks back, the first patient. We can call it as an index patient. Then from him, the symptoms was spreading. And there is a clustering, a group of patients are affected. And again, patients are having unusual clinical features. So a clinician can put all these things together. Obviously, he will be thinking about something like an unusual viral syndrome, which we have not seen before, but we are not sure what we are dealing with. So the same day evening, I've already told the other patients also became sick. We don't have a proper diagnosis at that time. So we have to diagnose these unusual viral syndrome. So the option was, you have to get these samples tested from some virology institute. Luckily, the virology institute director in Manipal was my close friend. So I called him and explained him, we have the patients like these, they are having unusual problems and we are suspecting new virus or unusual virus in this situation. So as per his instructions, like, we have collected all the samples of all these patients. And again, the samples were sent to toxicological examination as well. Sometimes toxin, like in the same family, like if they are exposed to some toxin, can also mimic these issues. Now the issue is, like, it's already evening 7 o'clock. We have collected samples. And think about that family, like, already another story in that family is that one boy died almost a few months before following a road traffic accident. So three sons already, two sons died, one son is very sick, now the father is also very sick on ventilator. So evening 7 o'clock, I have to convince the family that you have to take these samples to a place which is almost 300 kilometers away. So I told them, like, this is the situation, and I clearly told, I may not be able to save your family, but this is a disease which is going to spread. It can affect your other family members, even the persons that are, like, exposed, we can get affected. So only option is, like, get it tested immediately. So you have to travel to Manipal and deliver the sample immediately. So they listened to our request, and they delivered the sample to the Manipal Virology Center on the same day and night itself. So by next day morning, I've told, like, we have three patients in the ICU and one patient already in the ward, and again one patient already died. Still we don't have a proper diagnosis. So, and the patient was admitted in a critical care department. We have two more consultants working with me. And we have seen so many patients like this. We also have adequate experience in treating such patients. But when in a difficulty, there is no point in taking everything on your head. You have to make a team. So what we did was, immediately we formed a team, medical team, from different specialties. We called for a bedside meeting. We had a brainstorming discussions about different possibilities, like what it can be, what are the disease with these symptoms. So we thought about different possibilities. And in that discussion, actually, we came up with the thought that it can be the Nipah virus infection, because some symptoms, and again the clustering, was described with this Nipah infection before. And again, as I told, it can be something related to toxin also, which we have already sent to the toxicology center. So when we have this Nipah virus in our mind, the next thing is, like, we have to see how it is spreading. So usually it is starting from the bats, then from the pigs to the human beings. So to have a clinical suspicion, you should establish the connection with the pigs or with the bats. So they were from a Muslim community where there is no connection with the pigs at all, and there is no pig farms also around. So you have to find some connection to the bats to have a clinical suspicion of Nipah. So again, we went back, we asked them. So they were purchased a new land near this forest. This is ecotourism center, and there are enough bats in that area. And they were again admitted that they were consumed half bitten fruits. So again, we had a strong suspicion that it can be Nipah, because we have established a connection with the bats as well. So immediately, what we can do, we have again called the virology center, told that we have a strong suspicion that this can be Nipah, and Nipah has to be tested. Next morning, that is the second day, by about 1 o'clock, that first patient died. Again, we are not having any diagnosis. We have sent the sample, like, we have a suspicion that it can be Nipah, but still we don't have a diagnosis. So only possibility left at that point is, do a medical autopsy, or the patient died with fever, you examine him, examine his body, and send the organs for examination to find what is the infection. And again, remember, I have to convince a mother who has already lost their three sons, and the husband is also dying. I have to go and talk to them, saying that your son has already died, your husband is also dying, but we have to do the autopsy on this patient to establish the diagnosis. It was a very difficult task for me. But we explained to them that this is the situation. So this is the only way by which you can save the community. So I was shocked. Like, she was actually agreed that to go ahead with the autopsy. And again, we have done the autopsy, and the samples were also sent to Manipal Virology Institute immediately. So by 9 o'clock on the same day, that is the second day, we got the call from the virology center that they have identified an unusual virus, probably Nipah, which has to be tested and confirmed again. So by that time, again, like it was like so many persons were already exposed. I myself by that time examined 4 persons without adequate recommended like precautions. It is not that I have done a great thing. By mistake we have done, because we are not thinking that like it was such a deadly virus. So as you know, Liz, Nipah, like when we go back and search the literature, it's one of the priority virus listed by WHO, one of the 8 priority viruses listed by WHO, which can produce serious outbreaks in the world. So immediately, like the news started spreading, the Calicut city was almost empty. The people were hesitant to come out of their houses. Like the public transport were empty. The school remains closed. And again, the Calicut city became almost like a ghost city. And again, the all international attention was on Calicut city. Like there was again the threat on travel ban, the freeze on the export of fruits, and so many problems. So again, when we went back and saw the history, there were hundreds of deaths in the past. You can see the previous outbreaks, the deaths were 100. And again, the diagnosis was delayed. But but one thing you have to understand, these all people sacrificed their life and they paved path for the quickest diagnosis what we made. And again, they have documented everything very beautifully. Only with those documents, we were able to establish the diagnosis so fast. Then everything is an history. Immediately the team was formed. The health minister, she came to Calicut. They formed a team, district administrative team, health department, and again the medical professionals, then the central team, the intelligence, the animal husbandry. The whole team was formed and the whole control was taken over by them. And again, it was a new insight to me, how then adversity can bring the best out from the people. I've seen that how the people are reacting to that. And again, how the people, in a group, they'll react to the emergencies. That also I was able to experience. But the problem with me at that point of time was, I've already told, I myself was exposed to 4 persons. So when we made the priority list, I was one among the person with the highest chances of getting infected. My all team members were infected. My the best friends, my close team members, all were exposed. And again, you have to understand at that point of time, all the infected persons have died, or the mortality rate was 100%. Means if you are getting infected, the chances of dying is 100%. And again, another side, there is a public aspect also. I have to take care of my ICU team. Still, we have 3 patients in the ICU. And again, I have to convince the public authority and again the government what is happening. So I have to balance between these two. And again, the multitasking became my way. I have 3 patients in the ICU. I have to treat them. I have to convince the relatives about the seriousness. And again, I have to counsel them. I have to give courage to my team members, because if I stand in front only, they will come and take care of the patients. I have to stand with them. And again, when the my team members, few in the list, when they got fever and got admitted, I literally had to sit with them and again convince them that we also will be there. And again, I've already told, I'm also exposed, so don't worry. So I have to convince them. Then for me, I've already told, I had 2 options. I'm already exposed. And again, at any time, I can be also infected and die. So I can either retract back, aiming for my last days, or I can positively utilize my last days. That was the thought in me. So I decided to come out. And again, I started utilizing social medias. I started talking to the people in their language, how the disease spread, what are precautions you have to take. And again, I told the story how this mother showed the courage to give the consent for autopsy. And again, by that time, the only remaining member in that family, one boy, he came with wearing gloves, mask, everything. Then he asked me, how many days it will take for me to join my my family members in their death. So literally, I was not having any words to explain. So I removed the mask, gloves, and I hugged him. And immediately after that, the second video, I told the public, you don't have to worry. Like, this is a boy who is exposed. And I am also the person who is exposed to all these infected patients. So you don't have to worry. And again, those patients who are exposed, they won't be infective. They will be like spreading the disease only when they are symptomatic. So set yourself as example, then explain to the public, then they'll listen. Same way, we have to make a good team, because see, I have all the exposed persons. So I have to maintain the team. So I have to sit with them. And again, I started exposing them also through the media. That also gave them more courage. And by this time, even the dead bodies were not given to the relatives. So that was all buried or cremated in the city itself. So there were issues with that. And the people were not getting the chance to see or touch their the loved ones. And again, like, that is another lesson. Like, whenever you have someone to love, you love them, because when you have such an incident, you may not be even able to see or touch them during their last time. And by this time, the sister Alini, who was taking care of the first patient, she also died. And again, you all might have read the commitment she has shown. And again, actually, she was also giving us a big lesson, especially to the medical professionals, how committed you should be to the patients and how much love you have to give to your patients. So during this time, the cousin of the first patient who was taking care of all these patients, like when he was cleaning the room of our first patient, he found out that he was reading the Malayalam version of this Gabriel Garcia's novel, Love in the Time of Cholera. So if I am getting a chance to write a book, obviously the name should be Love in the Time of Nipah. And again, with the teamwork, what we have already described, with the whole society, the politicians, everybody, they all stood together. Then again, we fought against Nipah. And within the shortest time of 12 days, we were able to come out of this deadly Nipah virus. Thank you so much.